There is nowhere in the Bible a more deliberate illustration of the importance of God's holy law than in the most holy place of the sanctuary that is actually a pattern of the eternal one in heaven. As we know by studying the sanctuary, the throne of the ever-living God is a blood-sprinkled throne. In fact, without the spilling of blood, there is no other approach to a holy God. For it is written in Romans 5, verses 8 and 9, "But God commendeth his love towards us, in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more then, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him." And yes, this is why Satan attacks God's holy law in the way that he does, even to this day. It represents the God of creation, as well as the law of the land in New Jerusalem. This is also why Jesus said in Matthew 7, verses 20 to 21, "Wherefore, by their fruits ye shall know them. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven." The fruit of the true Christian has to do with obedience and how they keep God's law. The dying enemy of our souls knows this, and not only does he attack it, we can clearly see this focused attack in the Bible. In Esther's day, for example, Satan tried to force God's people to break God's law by passing and then enforcing laws of the land that went directly against God's commandment number 2. In Daniel's day, Satan moved his pawns again in government to get laws passed against both commandments number 1 and 2. And as prophesied in the last days, he will soon get laws passed against God's 4th commandment. This is why the word remember starts off commandment number 4. The Lord knew we would be taught to forget it. And this is why Satan has been working on this since 321 AD, when he moved most Christians back then and all the way up to our present day to believe God changed this Sabbath from the 7th day of the week to the 1st day of the week, as if Satan can somehow get God off his throne, open the lid of the mercy seat, take the 10 commandments out, and rewrite it. He even mocks the Creator God by picking Sunday, in which every pagan knows was originally named after the sun god Baal, which, as we all know, is just another form that Satan used to garner worship. Those that keep God's law as Christians have the fruit of the Holy Spirit within them that Jesus spoke of and are therefore declared to be the sons and daughters of God. But those that believe the many false prophets and apostate pastors who declare the law of God is no longer binding upon mankind, these poor souls have no fruit of the Holy Spirit in them and are therefore declared to be the sons and daughters of the dying God of this world. God's law is hated by Satan in a very intense and well-focused manner because it is that very law that caused him to be forever cast out of heaven. The Ten Commandments is, in fact, the law of the land in New Jerusalem. That's why Jesus said, "Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven." If they don't keep his law, they can't get in the city. And since Satan refused to keep it, he was cast out from heaven. He was the first one, in fact, to be cast out. Nary a false prophet, preacher, or pastor today will read unto their congregation that which is written in Psalms 103, verse 20, which is this: "Bless the Lord, ye his angels, that excel in strength, that do his commandments, hearkening unto the voice of his word." They won't read that passage because it shows that they lie when they say that the law is only for the Jews, when the Bible says the angels kept it long before a Jew was ever even born. In fact, Satan could not have been kicked out of heaven unless he broke God's law, and Adam and Eve could not have been removed from the garden unless the law of God was already binding upon them as well. Those that see no binding of the law upon their hearts as Christians today are those poor souls that do not have that law written on the fleshly tables of the heart as promised by our Lord in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 3. Their apostate pastors do not teach them of its eternal importance because unless they truly have Christ as Lord, they cannot see the importance of the law that is inside the Ark of the Covenant, which is the throne of the very God they claim to preach for. And so they too are slated for hellfire because, as prophesied, sin will not rear its ugly head again anywhere in the universe due to what is penned in Nahum chapter 1, verse 9, which is, "What do you imagine against the Lord? He will make an utter end. Affliction shall not rise up the second time." In other words, when Satan's dead, it's it. No more sin. As Revelation 22:14 clearly says, only those Christians that keep the law of God will be allowed into the city of New Jerusalem, or heaven, as some call it today. In fact, for those of us that study and understand prophecy, we know that after sharing the prophetic warning about the mark of the beast in Revelation 14, we see that after that warning is given, it says this in Revelation 14:12. In other words, the verses 6 to 11 talk about who get the mark of the beast and why. Well, verse 12 talks about who doesn't get the mark of the beast and why. It says, here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Yeah, I go into a lot more detail about this on my Mark of the Beast page. But to summarize it, we see that the obedient Christians are those that keep God's law, and in so doing, will never receive the mark of the beast, because the mark is specifically designed to be a bold and obvious attack on God's law by deliberately teaching all on earth that they must keep the man-made Sabbath of Sunday holy instead of the Sabbath created by the Lord himself, as it is decreed in commandment number 4. And again, that's why commandment number 4 starts off with the word remember. As I shared in a video years ago, the fourth commandment boldly speaks of the Creator God and all he did for us in creation. And so those that want to acknowledge him as Creator and obey him out of love for him are those that keep the only day of the week that he sanctified in creation week. That is how important God's law is to him. And that is why it is literally inside the Ark of the Covenant, under the mercy seat of God himself on his throne. In other words, not even Satan can get God off his throne to change his law. Can't be done. It is that blunt. It is that important. And that is why Satan seeks all to keep Sunday holy. Satan is at war with the God of creation. And so he will most assuredly focus on the one commandment in God's holy law that explicitly points him out as the Creator of all that is seen and unseen, as well as the very God that wrote the law in the first place that caused Satan to get kicked out of heaven long ago. And yes, you're correct to think this is all about revenge. Satan is that spiteful, malicious, and bitter. Like any rival king that attacks an enemy so as to defeat and conquer that nation, Satan goes after the king of New Jerusalem by focusing on his law to both belittle it as fragile, which then cultivates sympathizers onto his cause, of which he can use as troops on the long prophesied day of Armageddon, which is racing towards us at this time. Most souls think the Pope's climate change has to do with global warming or simple planetary environmental deviations. But students of prophecy, we know it all has to do with what Jesus said is going to happen on the planet right before he returns. That's right. What you're looking at in the news about all the natural disasters is a lie designed to cover up the fact that Jesus Christ is coming very soon. The Pope and those that bow to him are doing all they can to hide the fact Jesus is in fact coming. That's what all these natural disasters are about. The law of the Creator God is not fragile. It's not weak. It's not feeble or even insignificant, as Satan and his many false prophets proclaim from their apostate pulpits. It was etched in stone and placed under the mercy seat of the throne itself to declare its permanence, because the Creator God that penned it is also permanent. He is also eternal. He is also everlasting, and he is never-ending. Think about it. For Satan to be able to do away with God's law would mean Satan would have power to defeat God, the God of all creation. And that, my brothers and sisters, is nothing more than a dwindling boast of a dying fallen angel named Beelzebub. He is simply the wretched father of lies himself, and those people that refuse to obey the ever-living God of truth will have no recourse but to obey the dying God of lies. For prophecy doesn't only predict this holy war we find ourselves in, it predicts the utter destruction of Satan and all that follow him in hellfire as well. For when it speaks of what the obedient Christians will eventually do unto those that die with Satan in hellfire after the Lord does his strange act upon the wicked, as Isaiah 28 verse 21 called it, it says this of the eternal fate of the lost in Malachi chapter 4, verse 3. It says, ye, obedient Christians, ye shall tread down the wicked, for they shall be ashes under the soles of your feet in the day that I shall do this, saith the Lord of hosts. And yes, the many false prophets also lie to you about what actually happens in hellfire to keep you in their churches. I have a page on the website all about this lie. The obedient people of God will not only witness the eternal damnation of the lost at the end of the 1,000 years, which I also go into detail here on my website, they will walk on their ashes the very day that the Lord does his strange act. By keeping the law of God and having his Holy Spirit, which moves us to keep it, and especially by keeping his seventh-day Sabbath holy, which shows we believe him to be our creator, we declare him as both creator and God, worthy of worship. We show that we love our God, and we embrace his Son as Savior, who out of love for us wrote his law in our hearts to allow us to both gain entry into New Jerusalem as well as glorify him as God. And we do this by showing all the world, even the universe itself, that although mankind knows it is impossible to keep God's law, we show that when we accept Jesus as Savior, he helps us keep it by sending his Spirit, his Holy Spirit within us, to pen that law in our hearts. That act is a visible act and an undefiable fact of being a child of the living God of the Bible. Those that don't believe in Christ can't understand how we keep that law. That's what angers them. But the basic reality is we do not keep his law to get saved, because no man can. We keep his law because we are saved, which every man can be if they just accept Christ as Savior. It is the hope of the Seventh-day Remnant people that those with eyes that see and ears that hear accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, so as to gain real and absolute peace on this violent and dying world, and then gain eternal life in heaven. Thank you for watching. God bless.